Hi guys, in this video we are going to cover a recent RBI notification which is based on the concept of interest rate options. Now before moving forward, let us look at the relevance of this topic with respect to our examination. Now with respect to NABARD, this is relevant to the ESI portion under the subtopics reforms in banking financial sector and current economic and social issues. And with regard to the RBI, this is linked to the FM portion and this can be linked to the subtopics basics of derivatives, forward futures and swaps, recent developments in financial sector. So this is the notification which has been issued recently and this relates to interest rate options in India, and this is very recent notification which was issued on 14th of June 2018. So this is relating to interest rate options in India. So we to understand these this notification, we have to be aware about the concepts related to interest rate options, and they have also been amply discussed in this notification also. Now first and foremost, what does this notification has to say? Now this notification, it reads as follows. The RBI says, please refer to our previous circular which was issued on 29th of December 2016 on the introduction of interest rate options in India. So initially these interest rate options were introduced in the notification dated 29 December 2016, and now in this particular notification, in reference to the first bi-monthly monetary policy statement of 2018-19 dated 5th April 2018, it was decided to permit interest rate swaptions in rupees. So this is in continuation with the earlier continuation of the earlier directions which were issued in 2016, and now we are deciding that we have to permit the interest rate swaptions. Now these interest rate swaptions, they are a composition of two types of derivatives. One is swap and other is options. So now we are permitting these special kind of derivatives in interest rate in rupees, and these are being permitted so as to enable better timing facility flexibility for the market participants seeking to hedge their interest rate risk. So we'll see that derivatives are an important instrument to hedge your risks, and one of the important risks is the risk which arise due to movements in interest rates. For example, if you do an FT in the bank, you got an FT from the bank and that is paying an interest rate of 6%, but you feel that okay, I have locked my money for 3 years at 6%, but I now feel that after 1 year the interest rate may rise and I may still get only 6%. So in this case I should not lose the money, rather I should do some kind of arrangement in which I gain the money. So to enjoy these benefits, we have different interest rate options which are there, and these are also available on the stock exchange, and these can also be over the counter, meaning that one person can simply enter into these this kind of a contract with another person without getting into the ambit of stock exchange, and for this there are separate rules and regulations which have been prescribed in this notification. So we are going to cover all these aspects. We are going to discuss what are interest rate options, what are the different kinds of derivatives, what are the different types of interest rate options, what are interest rate swaptions, and the related aspects of this particular notification in this particular video. Now before moving forward, let us quickly recap the concept of derivatives. Now this concept of derivatives have been thoroughly discussed by us in the notes and the video lectures which are based on finance and management. So you have guys are requested to cover the concept of derivatives from those particular notes before jumping onto this particular video. But briefly, let us recap this particular concept. Now the derivatives, they are financial instruments which are deriving their value from any underlying asset. Now this underlying asset can be either stocks, or it can either be bonds or currency or commodity, or it can even be interest rates. This is the area of discussion. This is the key focus area for this particular video, that even interest rates, they can be the underlying asset for derivatives, and the value of the underlying asset, it can change from time to time, and then there arises a opportunity to make risks by betting on the future value of underlying asset. The different types of derivatives, they can either be futures, options, forwards and swaps. Now future and forwards, they are similar ones, and the forwards are simply over the counter and futures are simply exchange traded, in which one party is buying and the other party is selling. And options, there is this only right but not the obligation, and then there are swaps in which two parties, they are swapping Suppose if one party has a floating interest rate contract and the next part other party has a fixed interest rate contract, the two parties are there simply doing swapping. They are simply swapping their contracts. So these can be the different underlying assets on which the value of derivatives can be based, and our area of discussion in this particular video is going to be derivatives which are based on interest rates. Now in this particular video, our key area of discussion is interest rate options. So to understand this better, let us quickly recap the concept of options. Now options are contracts that grant the right but not the obligation. So these are those contracts which involve the right but they do not carry any obligation to buy or sell an underlying asset at a set price on or before a certain date. For example, you feel that the share of Reliance, which is priced today at around rupees 100, you feel that the price of the share is going to be rupees 200 1 month from now, and you do not want to buy that particular share now, and you have to buy this particular share 1 month from now, but you feel that now you should lock the price of this particular share by paying some other person some premium for locking this price of share at rupees 100. So there is another person in the market who feels that the price of the share of Reliance, it is going to come down in the coming month, it is going to be lower than rupees 100 after 30 days. So he comes to you and okay, he says, I am willing to enter into this particular arrangement that if you pay me rupees 50 today, I promise you that I will sell you the share of Reliance at rupees 100 30 days from now. Now since you feel that okay, the price is going to be higher than 100, you pay him rupees 50 and lock the price at rupees 100, and this way you are getting a right but you do not have any obligation. You may or may not enter into that transaction at a future date, but you have purchased the right to enter into that transaction. So this is simply the option which you have bought. So since this is the right to buy, this is will be called as a call option, and if it was a right to sell, then this would be a put option. So if you were selling the share of Reliance, you were acquiring the right to sell the share of Reliance at a locked price, then it would be put option. And the party that is buying, that is taking a long position, it is termed as the buyer or the holder of the option, and the party that is taking a short position, that is the party that is selling the option by taking a premium, that party is called the seller or writer of the option. So this is the basic concept of options. Now what are interest rate options? Now as per the definition which is provided by RBI in these directions, an interest rate option is a financial derivative contract whose value is based on rupee interest rates. So it simply says that interest rate option is a type of financial derivatives. So we know what are financial derivatives. Those financial derivatives whose value is based on the interest rates in rupees, those derivatives are interest rate options as per the RBI definition. Now typically an interest rate option is one that derives its value from the change in interest rates. Now why would you wish to have these interest rate options? Now the need arises because suppose today you have taken a loan and the interest rate on that particular loan is a floating interest rate, that is the interest rate, it depends on the market interest rates. So if the market interest rate is say 6%, then the interest rate on your loan is based on the same, it will be around 6.5% say, and you feel that the market interest rate, it may keep on rising, and ultimately your interest cost, it may keep on rising. Now there is another person in the market who feels that interest rates, they are going to decline in the market, and that particular person, he comes to you and he says, okay, if you want to enter into an agreement, if you want to lock your interest rate, then what you can do, you can pay me some premium, and on the basis of that particular premium, you can pay me a fixed interest rate, and you can transfer your floating interest rate burden to me. If there is any fluctuation in the floating interest rates, then I will bear that particular loss, so you have to pay me premium for that. Now in this case, you have acquired this particular right, you have acquired this right without any obligation, that you have fixed your interest rate obligation. So this is a kind of option which is there in the form of interest rates. So this interest rate option is a financial derivative that allows the holder that to benefit from the changes in interest rate. any user carrying any underlying interest rate risk, as in the example we just discussed, if you are having any underlying interest rate risk, you can enter into an interest rate option contract for hedging this underlying risk. So you are feeling that the interest rate may keep on rising, and you felt that you have to lock this interest rate, you have to fix this interest rate by paying a premium, and then you can hedge your risk by paying this premium or by acquiring the interest rate options. So this is the basic concept of interest rate options. Now let us take a look at the applicability of these directions. Now these directions, they shall be called as interest rate options Reserve Bank Directions 2018, and they will replace the earlier directions which were issued in December 2016. Now the transactions which are undertaken in terms of the previous directions which are those of the December 2016, these transactions, they will continue to remain valid. That is, their validity will remain intact and they will not be affected by the provisions in the recent or the latest directions. And these directions, they shall come into effect from a particular date, and which has been specified as 15th of June 2018, which is very important, as directly a question can be asked with regard to the effective date of enforcement of this notification. Now these directions, they shall be applicable to both exchange traded interest rate options and over the counter interest rate options. So we have seen that there can be two kinds of derivatives. One can be the derivatives which are traded on stock exchanges or commodity exchanges. Another derivative can be that kind of derivative which is not traded on the exchanges, rather they are over the counter derivatives. In these derivatives, you are simply coming into contact with another person outside the stock exchange to enter into these interest rate options contract. So these directions, they are going to apply to both types of contracts, exchange traded as well as over the counter. Now in case of exchange traded interest rate options, the procedure with regard to execution and settlement, this is going to be governed as per the rules of the relevant stock exchange. So this is going to be influencing factor with regard to exchange traded interest rate options. So this is with regard to the applicability of these directions. Now as per these directions, what are the eligible products or which are the products which have been permitted with regard to interest rate options? Now the directions state that any entity, it shall be eligible to transact in the following European interest rate options. So first, it restricts the type of options to European options. No American options are allowed. We'll study the difference between the two in the coming slides. So it says that you may enter into any of the following European interest rate options. So these are the different interest rate options in which you can enter as a part of these directions. So these are call and put options, interest rate collar or reverse collar option, interest rate swaption, interest rate caps or interest rate floors. So these are the type of permitted products under this particular directions. So the scope of these directions is very wide, and these are covering almost all types of interest rate options. Now let us take a look at each of these interest rate options. So let's start with the different types of interest rate options which are allowed as per these directions. The first one is interest rate call option. Now, like any other option, it is a right but not the obligation in which you are receiving an interest payment based on a variable interest rate, and you are paying an interest payment which is based on fixed interest rate. So these are those options in which you will be entering if you feel that the interest rates in the market, they are going to rise. So if the interest rate in the market, they are going to rise, you are going to feel lucky if you get the interest payments, interest income based on a variable interest rate which would rise according to the rise in the market rates, and you will simply be paying the interest rate which is already fixed. So this is the kind of option which you will be exercising, you will be buying if you are bullish on the interest rates, you feel that the interest rates in the market, they are going to rise. So you are acquiring the right to receive an interest payment based on a variable interest rate and paying only fixed rate. Now the other one is interest rate put option. Now this one is opposite of interest rate call option. In this option, you are acquiring the right to pay an interest payment based on a variable interest rate. So in this case, you feel that interest rates in the market, they are going to decline, and you feel that you have to receive a fixed interest rate, you do not want to get affected by the declining interest rate, you will pay the declining interest rate, but you will get or you will receive only a fixed interest rate. So in this case, you are receiving fixed interest rate and you are paying variable interest rate, which you expect it will be lower since the market rates, they are going to decline. So this is put option. Now next one is European option. Now European option means that particular option which could be exercised on the expiration date. Now the other kind of option is American option, which can be exercised at any time before the expiration date also. These directions which are issued by RBI, they only include European options within the definitions part. So they only relate to European options and they are silent on the American options. So we have to only take into account the concept of European options while talking about these particular interest rate options as per the recent RBI directions. Now the next one is interest rate cap. Now interest rate cap, it means a series of interest rate call options. So it means you are buying the right to enjoy the rise in the interest rates. So this is a series of interest rate call options in which the buyer of the option receives a payment at the end of each period when the underlying interest rate is above a rate agreed in advance. So you are agreeing on a rate in advance, you are agreeing on an interest rate in advance, and if the interest rate actually which is prevailing it is higher, then you are going to receive payments. So like the interest rate call option, these are also the right to enjoy the increase in the interest rate. Now the next one is interest rate floor. Now, interest rate floor, it means a series of interest rate put options in which the buyer of the option receives a payment at the end of each period when the underlying interest rate is below the strike rate. So like the put options, this is similar to the put options, but this is just a series of put options. You will be receiving the payment if the market interest rate is below the pre-decided rate or the strike rate, which is the pre-decided interest rate. Next one is interest rate swap. Now interest rate swap, it is a financial contract in which the two parties, they are coming together and they are agreeing on swapping their stream of interest payments. Now suppose one party is paying interest rates on fixed rates basis, so the party's interest rate is fixed, that is it has to pay suppose 8% interest rate, whatever be the interest rates in the market. Now there is another party whose interest rates, they are floating interest rate and they depend on the market interest rate. Now both the parties feel that they should exchange their interest rates. The fixed interest rate, one party, it feels that the market interest rates, they are going to decline and I do not have to pay fixed interest rate, but the floating interest rate party feels that the market interest rates, they are going to decline. So there is this notion in the minds of both the parties, and on the basis of this particular notion, both the parties enter into a transaction to swap their stream of interest payments, and this is called interest rate swap. The next one is interest rate collar. Now interest rate collar, it is a derivative contract in which you are simultaneously purchasing an interest rate cap and you are selling an interest rate floor on the same interest rate for the same maturity and notional principal amount. So all the aspects are same, but you are what? Purchasing an interest rate cap and selling an interest rate floor. So what you are doing? You are trying to fix your interest rate in a particular ceiling. You are trying to make sure that you do not have to pay an interest rate beyond a particular amount. At the same time, you are fixing your lower limit of interest rate, that is your benefit to enjoy the decline in the interest rate, to bear the decline in the interest rate as the case may be, it is going to be fixed. And you are fixing this by selling an interest rate floor. So you are purchasing interest rate cap, selling interest rate floor, and this is interest rate collar. Now the next one is reverse interest rate collar. Now reverse interest rate collar, it is simply the opposite of interest rate collar, and this is a derivative contract which involves simultaneous purchase of an interest rate floor and sale of an interest rate cap on the same interest rate for the same maturity and the notional principal amount. So this is simply the opposite of interest rate collar. Now the next is interest rate swaption. Now this is option plus interest rate swap combined. So under interest rate swaption, you are acquiring this particular right that in future you can swap your interest rate contract or interest rate loan with another person whose loan will be based on either fixed or floating opposite to debt of yours. Now in interest rate swaps, both the parties were agreeing. Now, in this interest rate swaption, one party is acquiring the right that if it wants to, then only it will swap the interest rate contract. So, this is interest rate swaptions. Now, let us understand these concepts of cap and floor in a better manner through these examples. Now, first let us take the understanding of interest rate cap option. Now, under this, let us take this example. Suppose there is a borrower and that particular borrower is paying a LIBOR interest rate on a loan, and that particular borrower, he wants to protect himself against a rise in the interest rate. So, his interest rate at present, it is based on LIBOR, that is London Interbank Offer Rate, and this particular rate is going to fluctuate, so its rate is based on the market. But now he wishes that he has to cap his interest rate obligations at just 2.5%, and he does not want to pay interest rate beyond this 2.5%. So if the interest rate exceeds 2.5% in any given period, the payment received from this particular derivative, it can be used to help make the interest payment for that period, and his interest rate is going to be effectively capped at 2.5%. So what happens? Now he is paying interest rate which is based on the market, but he enters into a derivatives contract which is to only bear the interest rate of 2.5%. So if the interest rates in the market, they rise beyond 2.5%, he will pay the rise in interest rate, but he will get an income which will be the difference between this 2.5% and the rise in interest rate, which is going to compensate him for the loss which arose due to rising interest rate. So he is simply trying to fix his upper limit or upper cap with regard to interest rate payments. Now let us understand the concept of floor. Now let us suppose there is a lender and he wants to secure a floating rate loan, and he is also looking for protection against lost income which may arise if the interest rates were to decline. Now if suppose there is a person who has lent his money according to floating or market interest rates. Now that particular person feels, what if the market interest rates, they decline? Now this particular person, he wants to fix a lower cap for his interest income. He does not want his interest income to decline beyond a certain limit. Now suppose this lender, he buys an interest rate floor contract with an interest rate floor of 8%. So minimum he has to get an interest income of 8%, and if the amount is $1 million, and what happens, the interest rates in the market, they fall to 7%. Now what would happen, he is going to be compensated for this particular 1% from the derivative or the options contract which he has entered into. So what will happen, this interest rate floor derivative contract, it is going to help him in getting this 1%, and this 1% is going to again make his income go up to 8%. He will get 7% from the loan and 1% from this derivative contract, and his interest rate is going to be effectively fixed at 8%. This is due to this floor interest rate contract. So this is all about the cap and floor interest rate options contract. Now let us also briefly understand the concept of interest rate collar. Now interest rate collar or a floor ceiling is an agreement where the seller or the provider of the collar, he is agreeing to limit the borrower's floating interest rate exposure to a specified ceiling rate and floor rate. So in the case of interest rate collar, you are not trying to simply cap the interest rate which will be the highest interest rate, but you are also going to cap, or you are also going to limit the bottom interest rate. You will not be enjoying any benefit if the interest rate, it falls below this particular floor rate. So you are simply trying to fix this ceiling. Okay, my interest rate will be for between 8% to 4%. You are entering into a contract that if interest rate increases beyond 8%, I will only pay 8%, but if interest rate falls below 4%, then also I will be paying 4%. I will not enjoy the decline beyond 4%. So this is the interest rate collar. You are buying the floor, you are buying the cap, but you are selling the floor. So what happens if the market rates, they exceed the ceiling rate, then the collar provider will make payments to the buyer, and this is going to cap your interest rates. But if what happens, the rates, they become lower than the floor rate, then what will happen, then you will going to be making payments to the collar provider. Now since you have sold these floor option, then you are going to be making the payments in case of interest rate declining below this particular floor, And then again, this is going to bring your interest rate, lower interest rate limit back to this floor level. So the idea behind this collar is to lower your upfront payment associated with the cap purchase. Now what happened, if you have simply purchased the interest rate cap, you would have brought a cap or you have brought a ceiling to your interest rate payments which you have to make. But however, this you can try to, the cost which you can which you are paying for buying this particular cap, you can limit or lower this particular purchase. How? You can sell a interest rate floor and you can get the premium for the same. So in this case, you feel that interest rates, they may not fall below this particular limit, and you try to fix this lower limit as your interest rate, and you enter into an agreement with another person that if the interest rate falls below this particular amount, I will bear the loss. You pay me this amount today. So you are selling this interest rate floor options contract. So you are getting this money, and this money in a way is offsetting your payments towards the purchase of a cap. So this is how the collar tries to reduce your upfront payment associated with the cap purchase. Now let us understand this concept of interest rate collar through this very simple example. Now suppose there is a borrower B, and this borrower has taken a loan with floating interest rate. Now this borrower is worried that if the interest rates in the market rise, I will have to pay increased interest payments. So this is the worry which is striking this particular borrower B, and he wants to hedge this risk which is associated with the rising interest rate. But at the same time, this person feels that his interest cost should not fall below a particular level. Now it may happen that he also feels that interest rates are not going to fall beyond a particular limit. So he feels that interest rates, they are not going to fall below the level of 4%. So what he does, he purchases an interest rate cap or call option at 8% interest. So this means that if the interest rates, they rise beyond this 8%, he is going to be compensated for this increase in interest rate by that other particular party by paying a premium. So he pays a premium and acquires this particular option that if interest rate, they rise beyond 8%, you will have to compensate me. But he also sells an interest rate floor, which is the put option. So he sells the interest rate floor at 4% and earns the premium. So this is important. In the first case, he is the buyer, and in the second case, he is the seller. So he is selling the interest rate floor. So what if the interest rate, it falls below the 4% level, he will have to compensate that particular other party because he has got the premium for that other party. Now that other party, it has put the risk of falling interest rate which may arise on that party's income to the borrower B. But this borrower is happy because he feels that the interest rate, it may not even fall below this particular level, and he will simply sit and enjoy the premium. Now what if the interest rates, they rise beyond 8% in the market? If the interest rate, they rise beyond 8%, B will be compensated. But if the interest rates, they fall below 4%, B will have to compensate the buyer of the floor option because he has got the premium for it. So effectively, B has kept his interest obligations in the range of 4 to 8%. So this is the concept of interest rate collar. Now why should he go for interest rate collar rather than going for interest rate cap? Now the advantage here is that in the case of interest rate collar, his cost is lower than if he had simply bought the interest rate cap, because now he has earned money by selling interest rate floor. So if he simply buys interest rate cap, he'll be paying premium. But if he simultaneously sells the interest rate floors, he earns the premium. So this is beneficial because this has lowered his borrowing cost. Now let us understand what does these directions have to say about participation in the OTC markets. Now since the participation which is there in the exchange markets, it is going to be regulated, but this participation in OTC markets, it needs some regulation, and the participation, the persons who can participate, they have to be effectively pre-decided or prescribed in the directions. So these have been prescribed as, so these directions says that there will be only two types of participants, one will be market makers and the other one will be users. So the market makers, they are either banks or standalone primary dealers or other regulated entities which have obtained the prior approval of their respective regulators. Now the banks, they can only become the market makers if they fulfill this criteria, that is their net worth should be at least 500 crores and their capital adequacy ratio should be at least 9%. And with regard to the users, it says that all other entities which have underlying interest rate risk, they may participate as users. That is, they may hedge their interest rate risk by becoming a user and entering into the OTC markets with regard to interest rate options. But these users shall not be permitted to run net short positions in interest rate options. So this is to prevent speculation in the interest rate options, that you are not permitted to enter into net short positions. So you will only be taking long positions in which you have genuine risk and you have to hedge that particular risk. So the market makers, they will create the market for this OTC transactions, and the users, they will use this particular market to enter into the transactions with regard to these OTC. For example, the particular user, it can enter into a transaction with regard to the interest rate options with the particular bank. So this will be an OTC transaction, and these will be the two parties. One will be the bank and the other one will be the users. So these can only be the two parties. One party has to be a market maker, which can either be a bank or a primary dealer or other regulated institution. Now, with regard to the underlying assets, with regard to interest rate options, these directions, they state that for orderly market development, there will be fixed income money market and derivatives association of India, and this particular association, it is going to publish a list of objective and transparent debt instruments, and on the basis of these debt instruments, they are going to be used as underlying for different interest rate options contract in the OTC market and the recognized stock exchanges. So this association becomes important in this regard, that it is going to fix the interest rate on the basis of the list which it is going to publish. Now let us briefly look at some of the miscellaneous points. Now the contracts in the permitted interest rate options, it may be entered into either over the counter or on a recognized stock exchange. This we have also seen in the one of the earlier slides. Now introduction of a contract in an interest rate option on a recognized stock exchange, it shall be subject to the obtaining prior approval of the Reserve Bank by the exchange. So if a particular stock exchange, it wants that the interest rate options should be traded on that particular exchange, it has to obtain prior approval of the RBI. Further, a market maker, that is a bank, simply a bank, the bank has to report all the over-the-counter transactions in interest rate options within 30 minutes of entering into that particular transaction. And this particular reporting has to be done to the Trade Repository of Clearing Corporation of India Limited. So guys, here we end our discussion on this particular notification. And I understand that this notification was a bit technical notification and it had a lot of technical terms which were there. But we do not have to be thorough about all these particular terms. We do not have to have perfect knowledge about all these terms. We have to simply cover the basics of derivatives, as we have seen in the second slide, which talked about the relevance with regard to the syllabus of NABARD and RBI. So we have to simply be aware about the basics of the concept of derivatives and options. And to recap, we have to just know about these particular concepts. We have to know what is the meaning of derivatives, what are the different types of derivatives, and what can be the different types of underlying assets in the derivatives. Very basic and very simple part. And with respect to this notification, we have to know what was the basic idea behind bringing this notification. The basic idea was to permit interest rate swaptions in the country. So we have to be aware about simply the basic idea and the basic aspects of this notification. Now we have to aware about the basics of the concept of interest rate options. So for this, we have to be aware about what are options and why do we need options with regard to interest rate. Very simply, to hedge the risks in the interest rate transactions. For example, there can be interest rate risks with regard to the floating interest rate transaction or fixed interest rate transaction, and you have to hedge that particular risk. And for this particular hedging purpose, there are the interest rate options. So we have to just remember this. And there are different types of interest rate options, and we cannot be expected to be perfect about all those types. We have to simply remember that there are different types, and there can be call option, put option, there can be a cap, there can be a floor, there can be a collar. And we just have to simply know the basic idea, the basic meaning of the different types of interest rate options. Now, we could have gone into all the technical details of all those options contract. We have deliberately not gone into the detail of those all those types of interest rate options, because the same is not relevant for our examinations. And then again, we have to simply remember the important points with regard to notification. For example, we have to remember that it is going to apply on both over the counter and exchange traded interest rate options. So this is what you have to remember for the examination. Now let's discuss some of the important MCQs based on the notification we have just covered. So first question, it's based on the very simple concept of derivatives. Which of the following is incorrect regarding derivatives? They derive their value from underlying assets. They help to make profits by betting on the future value of the underlying asset. They are never traded on stock exchange. All of the above are correct. So this is a very easy question based on the simple concept of derivatives. So we have covered this concept of derivatives, and we know that the derivatives can be either over the counter or they can be traded on the exchange. So in this case, the option number C, which is there, is going to be incorrect because it says that they are never traded on stock exchange. So C will be the answer. Which of the following type of derivatives gives the holder the right without any obligation on the payment of premium? So we have seen that there are different kind of derivatives. There are futures, there are forwards, there are options, and there are also swaps. So these are the different kind of derivatives which are there in the market, and all of them have their different unique features. Now one particular kind of derivative which offers this facility to obtain the right on payment of a premium to enjoy the upside of any security, to enjoy the benefits of any security, is option. So in this case, the answer is going to be option number C, options. Let's move to the next question. Which of the following correctly describes call option? So we have seen that there are different types of options, and one of the type is call option. And we are being asked, what is call option? Right to buy, right to sell, obligation to buy, or none of the above. So this we have seen that call option means the right to buy. So if you are buying a call option, it means that you are acquiring the right to buy a security at a particular price at a particular future date. So this right you purchase by making some premium, by making some payment in the form of premium. So the answer to this is going to be option number A. Next question. RBI has recently issued interest rate options Reserve Bank Directions 2018. These directions shall come into effect from which of the following dates? Options are 1st April 2018, 15th June 2018, 1st October 2018, 15th January 2019. So this we have seen that these directions, they will come into effect from 15th of June 2018. So answer is option number B. Now the next question, an option which could be exercised by the buyer on the expiration date is called. Now options are American option, European option, call option, or put option. Now this question is directly picked from the one of the definitions which are given under these directions. So to answer this question, we must be aware about the definitions in the directions, and this definition in the directions is given in respect of European options. So the answer to this is going to be option number B, European option. Next question. Dash is a derivative contract where a market participant simultaneously purchases an interest rate cap and sells an interest rate floor. So we have covered this concept of different kinds of interest rate options. These are interest rate cap, these are interest rate floor, and then we combine both cap and floor, and we just try to fix our interest obligations in a particular ceiling, in a particular slab, and this happens in the case of interest rate collar. So answer to this is going to be option number C, interest rate collar. The other options were interest rate swap, interest rate swaption, or interest rate reverse collar. So you have to remember that this one is a reverse collar in which you are buying interest rate cap and selling interest rate floor. Next question. As per the interest rate options Reserve Bank Directions 2018, which of the following criteria is to be fulfilled by the banks in order to participate as market makers in OTC or over-the-counter markets? Options are net worth of not less than rupees 500 crores, CRAR, that is capital adequacy ratio, of not less than 9%, option number C, both A and B, option number D, none of the above. So we are being asked about the criteria which is to be fulfilled to participate as market makers by the banks. So if we read the directions as we have just seen in the previous slides also, this criteria comprises of two parts. One is that the net worth should be at least 500 crores and the next part is CRAR should be at least 9%. So both these are required to be satisfied. So answer to this is going to be option number C. Next question. As per the interest rate options, Reserve Bank Directions 2018, which of the following is are correct with regard to participation of users in OTC markets? So in the participation part of the OTC markets in interest rate options, we have seen that there are two participants. One is market makers and the other one is users. So the previous question was framed on the market makers. This question is based on users. Options are: all entities with underlying interest rate risk may participate as users. Users shall also be permitted to run net short positions in interest rate options. Both of the above or none of the above. Now in this particular case, we have seen that the first statement, which says that all entities with underlying interest rate risk may participate as users, this is true. But the second option, which says that users can enter into net short positions in these options, this is incorrect because users are not permitted in this regard. So answer to this is going to be only option number A. So these are the answers to the questions we have just covered. So guys, this is all about our discussion on one of the very important RBI notification in news recently, which is based on the interest rate options. Thank you.